Ndoto tulionayo njema kwa wana wetu ni ya kutupa moyo kurudi za yetu.
One thing as Muslims, since I'm talking to an Islamic channel, I'll say Alhamdulillah, we have the real grace that non-Muslims don't have, which is of istikhara. And when you do istikhara, you can't say law or lam, you can't say I should have, I shouldn't have. So to be honest, for me, because I did my istikhara, I'm very happy with what I've done. I will say that a lot of people around me would say, hey man, maybe you could have done this, maybe you could have done that, maybe you should have stayed in corporate, including family members. By Allah's grace, we have opened 4 branches in less than 4 years, and they're successful. Our franchisees are making money. So for us, Alhamdulillah, we are very happy where we are. And I'm very positive on this journey, inshallah.
Hijana walo wema walo na heshima walo beba himma kuinua umma. Hijana walo wema walo na heshima walo beba.
My name is Khider Farooq Adam. I come from the Adams family. I did my A-levels in Oshwal High in Kenya, and then I went to the UK for my degree. Those days, it was very rare to do a degree in media or something like that. We had mainly 4 streams. You either do medicine, or accounts, or engineering, or law. So, you know, I was very limited. So I chose engineering because I liked logical thinking, and I thought it was, you know, it would be fun. It wasn't. I didn't like it. I just came back and I went into sales and marketing, which is what I love. I'm a sales and marketing person. So I was fortunate that after I graduated, my first job was actually for a Dubai-based company. I worked with them for about 5 years. And then I worked for Procter & Gamble, which is basically the manufacturer of Pampers and Ariel. It's the world's largest consumer goods. I worked for them for 10 years. So by the grace of Allah, I succeeded. You know, in a very short time, I got promoted pretty well. I was doing very well for myself. But I reached a point where I got a bit bored of what I was doing. So I worked in Dubai, I worked in Saudi Arabia, I handled African countries. I handled countries from Angola, South Africa, Egypt, you know. I had a lot of exposure, which was great, but I reached a point when I found myself not getting fulfilled anymore. And that's when I decided to let me go into business. It wasn't an easy step, and I think like most people, I was doing a lot of side hustles. So I was trying small things. I would bring in dates for Ramadan, for example. I would try to import some. I have very strong networks. I would use them. Whenever I would travel abroad, I'd bring something. I went to China while I was still employed. I did a lot of side hustles. But I realized that it's hard to do too many things. You need to focus. So I decided, I took some time off from work. I took 6 months off as a sabbatical, which is unpaid leave. And I started doing different things. Our family would do property, so I did property. I went to China, as I told you. I tried to do some business there. And eventually I ended up in food, mainly because I realized if I needed a business that would pay me a monthly cash, sort of similar to a salary, then it has to be something like retail. And food, you know, the theory is that you can't go wrong with food. So I ended up in food, mainly because I wanted cash at the end of the month. I didn't want to worry about, you know, whether I'm going to have cash or not. I decided I was going to go into food. I didn't think of Snack Attack as a brand, but I very soon, after getting into the venture, I realized, within 3 months of deciding of going to food, I realized that it's a lot of work to learn, to build a product, to build a brand, to build a supply chain, and I suddenly realized that, you know, I need to look at franchising. So I looked for franchisors. I went to all these big American brands, and it didn't work for me. As a Muslim, they had a lot of requirements. They wanted me to serve alcohol, music, things I didn't agree with. So that was out. They also wanted a lot of money, which I didn't have. Then I found Snack Attack, which is a franchise from Pakistan. And I knew the owners. I met them a few years ago in Medina when I went for Umrah. So they offered me a very good partnership. I liked it. And alhamdulillah, we signed. That was about 5 years ago. And the main reason was, I think, because they were people I knew, they were affordable, and they were going to stick within my values. غيث البشائر في زهور سعادتي واستبشري يا شمس عند شروقك فالنور أشرق في تخرج طفلاتي يا غيمات الأفراح هلي وانثوري غيث البشائر في زهور سعادتي واستبشري. My first few years of business were difficult, I would say. Because my partners wanted me to start franchising, but we both agreed that before we can franchise, we must fix our core. So I was busy working on supply chain, marketing, building the brand. So we opened 4 stores. We opened Gong Road, we opened Koinange Street, we opened Sarit Center, which is where we are. And then more recently we just started franchising a year ago, where we did our first franchise in Mombasa. So the first few years were difficult because I wanted to franchise, but I also knew that I have to do all the homework before I can start. Having a business is really exciting. It's tough. I think there's a statistic online, you can check it up. It's about 20 or 30% of restaurants close within the first year. And 90% close within the first 5 years. So that's a scary statistic, you know. I think food is a very cool business to be in because you meet a lot of people. It's fun, if you're a social person, you'll enjoy it. But there's a lot of stuff that needs to come with it. The first few years were tough. Now we are in a very good position because we know exactly where we're going. We've done our first franchise, it's doing really well. So now for us, it's like we think it's the turning point for Snack Attack, where we want to expand, inshallah, with partners that would like to join us, inshallah. وتسلقت فرحا جبال الهمة وسمت بها كل. If you go into business and you think you're going to do everything yourself, you're going to fail. So letting the experts do what they're supposed to do. So for example, Snack Attack, we have a very strong marketing team that focuses just on what people are talking about. So that's one trait: the support, the right people, and making sure that you have the values across the team. I love the fact that people love our food. For me, it's all about customers, and right now I have two. I have the customer who buys a burger at Snack Attack or fries, and I have my franchisee who's my customer. And both of them, alhamdulillah, my franchisee in Mombasa is happy, he's making money. For me, that's amazing. You know, that's the most important thing. And my customer who comes to Snack Attack, and you can check, and I do that a lot, they usually give us 10 out of 10. They love the food. They love the food. They love the service. You know, we can improve on some areas, I'm sure, but overall, people love our food. That gives me real satisfaction. أفكارها فبدأت بأجمل حلتي واليوم يا فخري. One of my mentors was Java's owner, the first person who started Java, Kevin Ashley. He was my mentor for 2 years. And he told me, Khider, as soon as you start expanding, you're going to get busy. Focus on what matters. When you go to a store for 1 hour, focus on what you know is going to drive the results. So for me, as Khider personally, I'll give you I'll elaborate on that. I'm strong at marketing. I'm strong at selling. I still need to keep in touch with my numbers, so I do that, okay? But I make sure I'm putting most of my energy in growing the brand. And I have a good team that will make sure that the quality and operation is consistent. We have the cost of opening a franchise varies depending on the location. We're trying to bring it as low as possible. At the moment, we're trying to do a store that can generate about $8,000 to $10,000 profit per month for the franchisee after paying everything. To do that kind of store, you need about $8 to $10 million, depending on the location. It could go a bit higher, it could go a bit lower. There are three most important factors in fast food. Number one is location. Number two is location. Number three is location. You could have a great product, great marketing, great service, and rubbish location, won't work. And you could have a rubbish product, rubbish service, and a great location, and you might just succeed. So I think location is key. Sarit is a great location, and that's our key for franchisees. We help them with really good locations, because I didn't take any of these new malls. They offered me space in the hub, in Two Rivers, and Gardens. I didn't take them. What is the advantage of being self-employed versus being employed, especially for a Muslim, as a Muslim? The number one thing is, when you are employed, you're limited in what you can say yes and no to. For example, one of the biggest issues we have today as an ummah is people who are working in big corporates. They can't pray on time. They can't avoid intermingling. They can't avoid big parties where alcohol is being served. And that's a reality. Wherever you're employed, at some stage of your employment, you're going to have to compromise on your Islamic values. Alhamdulillah, it's not impossible, but it's hard to do. In your own business, it's the same. It's still hard to do. You know, but you have a lot more control and you have a lot more ownership, because now the buck lies with you. If you decide to put music in your store, it's your decision, right? As a franchisor, Snack Attack will recommend, don't put music. Have your women dressed well. Close for prayer times, at least for Friday when you can. We'll not enforce it, but we will recommend it, okay? So I think you have a lot more control when you are your own boss, as far as your values are concerned, alhamdulillah, that's for sure. What maybe you don't have control of is, you know, the other side. Let me also put the other side of employment. When you're employed, the advantage you have of employment is it's secure, and you have more control of your time. What I mean by that is, you know, it's a 9-to-5 job, weekends are free, so you can plan better. With employment, at least initially, it's hard. With self-employment, sorry, it's hard. I don't think I'm able to take as many days off as I would when I was employed. The question about how do I balance between my work and my social and my religious life, and I was saying that I think all of us as Muslims have a responsibility. You have your work and your family, and then you also need to contribute to yourself. How do I become a better person? So you're own ibadat. And you also need to see, how am I affecting the lives of my family and my community? And for me, I think the work has been a blessing, because I'm able to choose my timings. I can choose, for examples, on Friday I decide to spend some time for the mosque, as an example. So I'm able to do that with my timings. On Sunday I'm at work. But on Tuesday, for example, normally I have time available for myself. So I think, alhamdulillah, being employed has that advantage. But that's not an excuse. For those brothers who are not being self-employed has an advantage. But it's not an excuse for those brothers who are employed. You still need to make time for your own ibadat and your own, your own service to the community. The importance of balancing your life is extremely important for everyone. I mean, even the most successful people in the world, if you read about them, you will notice a common trait. They do a lot for others. They do a lot for humanity. Read it up. If you read even the most successful traits of CEOs, you'll see two things at least in common. Number one, they all wake up early and they do some sort of prayers or meditation. All of them. Yeah, from Bill Gates to the Rupert Murdochs and everybody you talk to or you read about Afwan. The second thing, they all give to humanity. So some of them will give to charities. We as Muslims, we are fortunate. Allah has taught us. Care for Fajr, do Yadkar, Shaitl Ishraq, fast Monday, Thursday, be good to the neighbor, go to charity. Alhamdulillah, for us, it's spelt out for us. These guys, they have to turn 50, 60, then they realize this is what I want in my life. You and me, we don't have that problem. So I think it's extremely important to be balanced. Do everything. Have time for, as the hadith says, sawa sa. Time for everything. My advice to young Muslims is, number one, we are very blessed in the religion that we are. Our Prophet told us there's barakah in business, there's barakah in tijara. So learn from the best of the examples. Don't wait for science and some management school to tell you what we already know. So you know that business has got its barakah. Learn from, I think it was Abdurrahman bin Auf, who when he came to Medina, he had nothing. So the young person who has nothing to aspire to, he came, imagine living a wealthy lifestyle in Medina, in Mecca, and you come to Medina, and he had the easy option. So somebody is willing to sponsor you and say, I'll pay for everything, I'll give you a house, car, everything. And he says, don't do that, show me the market. That's our inspiration. We should be the ummah that goes to the market and learns. We should be the ummah that starts all these new fads, the Ubers and the Jumias and whatever. We should be doing it. Alhamdulillah, many of us are. So my advice is to the young who are sitting and don't get a job, don't wait for the job. Start business today. It's easier than it was 10 years ago. وتقدست أسماؤه وتعالى وأكون للوطن الحبيب مشيدا أنمى إليه وأستفيد جلاله. If you are a single young entrepreneur who has not much responsibilities, I would say jump in business. What do you have to lose? You know, what's the worst that's going to happen? You can always get a job, right? So my advice would be, think it through, of course, but don't worry too much about, you know, about the finances, okay? I would advise you to have a mentor. Mentorship is one thing that I really think as Muslims we need to do and generally helps you in life. Talk to people who have done it and failed. Talk to people who have done it and succeeded, okay? Don't take shortcuts when that is concerned. So I think what's unique about Snack Attack franchise is our story. Snack Attack is not like other food brands that have a legacy or 100, 200 years of experience in food and then now they're successful. We started with an engineer, who is me, starting a business in Kenya, and alhamdulillah in 4 years we opened 4 branches including 1 franchise. So we have a success story that is very homegrown Kenyan. I think that's unique about us compared to any other brand. ولو بما همنا تبين وهم كسوم واد تهدي كويل وعبادة إيمانيا توهدي ليو يهو عقدا نكسلي مسجدي وهنك وإدا ولو نماها وردي ليو يهو سعدا كفوق سوم فراذي نسونا وليبوم.